We've got a brand new ministry here at Calvary Baptist Church. It's called Grief Share. If you have ever lost a loved one, doesn't have to be a spouse, it could just be anyone in your life, and you're having a difficult time moving forward, this is an amazing ministry. It's every Thursday night from 6:30 till 8 right here at Calvary. You need to get hold of Melissa Neiman. You can reach her at 777-1962. This Thursday is going to be our Young at Heart lunch. And that means an amazing meal. I believe this meal is kind of like potluck or food surprise or whatever you want to call it. But you bring your favorite dish. There'll be some other things to go along with it. Some great warm fellowship and an uplifting word. So that's this Thursday, 12 o'clock, Young at Heart. In case you haven't heard, we are trying to raise some money for a playground picnic area. It's going to be over there where the old van hut or old ATM building is. It's going to take a little bit of money, so we've got a number of fundraisers. We've got some Calvary Baptist Church tumbler mugs out there, and we've got our brand new Just For You out there at a table. Minimum donation of $20 or whatever you'd like to give, and you'll learn more about what's on the front of this shirt and the back as I give my sermon today. Okay, on March 17th and 18th is our annual treasure hunt for our youth that sponsor it. If you've got some treasures, our youth are hunting for some. So if you've got some functioning appliances that you need to move out of the way for your new ones, or some recliners that you need to move out of the way for some new ones, they're looking for that. But no clothing, please. So if you've got some treasures, please contact Jonathan. He'll be happy to come by, or you can drop them off at the church either way. That's March 17th and 18th. Our annual student treasure hunt. That's all of our announcements this morning. I hope you came to worship, and if you have, then let's get ready to worship!
That's hard to follow. But let's stand together and greet one another as we sing, He Has Made Me Glad.
Enter His gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter His courts with praise. I will say, since the day that the Lord has made, I will rejoice that He has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for He has made me glad. He has made me glad.
Sorry. Yeah. Sorry. Sorry. Sorry about that. I'm here. I'm here.
He's coming.
I'm here. I'm coming. I forgot. Hey, good morning, folks. I was running around because I forgot my boot. Got to have a boot for the visual aid. Come on in, have a seat. Welcome to Calvary Baptist Church. If you're visiting with us for the first time, in our bulletin, it says, welcome guests. That'd be you. We'd love for you to fill that out. Take it to our welcome center out the back after church. We'd love to give you a special gift for worshiping with us. Or if you have a prayer request, please put it on there and put it in the plate. We'd be happy to pray over that prayer request. I held the boot here because today is the last Sunday in January. That means it's the last Sunday we're raising money for the Texas Boys and Girls Ranch. $5 gives one kid four meals. And so right now it's kind of empty. Please pray about this ministry. Please pray about how hungry kids are around here, how important food is, how you probably have a refrigerator and a cabinet full and kind of wonder, we ain't got nothing to eat. Well, these kids really need your help. They need your help for some food and for some strength. Also this morning, I'm not used to running around, Gary Crutcher comes and would like to give an announcement to you about Education Children's Department.
Guess what? Lots of people step forward. Amen. We can always use more. Especially on Sunday night. Right now, a lot of things are starting to get covered. Heppers and some teachers, too. You know, for some classes, we just need somebody to sit in there and kind of corral the kids or visit with the kids, you know, if you like to be around them. Because they like to be around us, I mean, well, except mine. But I want to thank you. I want to thank you for stepping forward. But like I said, we can always use more. We even have somebody step forward for a vacation Bible school. All we need is about 50 volunteers to go with that. You know, that sounds like a ridiculous amount, but that's pretty much about it. That's usually about what helps on vacation Bible school. So somebody step forward on that and are starting to plan it. But I want to thank you as much as anything else and tell you there's room for more. I'm telling you. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Gary. And it's all because you chose to make a difference. And that's what this whole campaign has been. You're not too old and you're not too young. You're not overeducated and you're not undereducated. We need your body and we need your love and your help. And a lot of ministries, as Gary said, just a few months from now, we'll be having our greatest outreach ever through VBS. And that takes a lot of people. So a lot's happening. A lot's going on. I know you're busy. I know you're over busy. But you always have time to do what you want to do. But I say this, God will give you all the time you need if you give him all your time to him. So that's all we have to do. Give him all our time. He'll give us an abundance. So thanks for coming to worship this morning. One of the ways that we also worship, and that's through prayer. A lot of times we make it through the week. I don't know if you have a daily devotional, but sometimes you get to the end of the week and you notice you're 5 days behind in your daily devotional. And so I think sometimes we look for the weekly devotional. Well, you know what? Then we'd be a month or so behind. So this morning at Calvary, as we do every Sunday morning, we invite you to a time of prayer. I'm going to be down here. You're welcome to come join me. Please lift up my wife, Kim. She's home with a migraine. If you've ever had one of those, you know they're quite debilitating. And so please pray for those who are ill, not feeling well, or pending surgeries or anything like that. But we also just want to ask to lift up this service. There's going to be a lot going on, special speaking, an amazing time of worship. So prayer is very important. The power of prayer is limitless when we go before the Lord. So let's do that right now.
Our Heavenly Father, our Lord, and our Master, we just come to you, Father, just thanking you for this day and the many blessings that you've given us. Father, we just want to thank you for letting us be in your house today. And Father, I just want to ask that you'll just keep your hand, that you'll just keep your hand upon our nation and just continue to bless our nation. And Father, we just ask that you'll just be with the President and Vice President. Father, we just ask that you'll just be with them, continue to give them the wisdom and knowledge that they need to have to make all the right decisions. And Father, we just ask that you'll just be with their families, just continue to bless them and protect them. And Father, we just ask that you'll just be with each one that's here, keep your hand upon us and just lead, guide, and direct us in all that we do. And Father, I just pray for the ones that's lost loved ones. Father, we just ask that you'll just draw them a little closer to you and just comfort their hearts. And Father, for the ones that's in the hospital and in nursing home, Father, we just ask that you'll just keep your hand upon them and nothing but your will be done in their life. And Father, if there's one here that needs to make a decision, whatever that decision is, I ask that they make it before it's too late. And Father, I just come to you just lifting my brother Steve up to you and ask that you'll just hide him behind the cross and just lay on his heart what you would have him to say. And Father, I just lift Ray up to you as he leads the music. I just ask that it just do nothing but honor and glorify you. And just go with us now, Father, through the rest of this service. Forgive us of our sins, ask these and all of the blessings for Christ's sake. Amen.
Amen. Hey, boys and girls, come on down this morning. Yep, here we go. It's time for you and me to have a little talk. It's not like going to the principal. It's even funner than that. Yeah, come on down. Sarah, good to see you. Man, good to see you guys this morning. Did you have an amazing week at school?
Yeah.
Okay, you excited about going back tomorrow?
Yes.
Okay, here's the test question. What is this?
Two boxes.
How come some of y'all didn't say anything? What goes in a shoebox?
Shoes.
Maybe
boots.
Maybe. So, If I put some ice in the bottom here and like a little jug of milk and a sandwich, could this be a refrigerator? Now, if I cut a hole in the side and stuck an electrical cord in here, put some wires and tubes and a screen, could this be a television?
No.
No. This was meant to be a shoebox for shoes, right? You know, there are times that we take things that are meant to be one thing and try to make it into another. Can I tell you what this morning? Yes. You have been made on purpose by God to fulfill His purpose. And a lot of times we're like, well, what is that? What is that? Well, we have to go through life to figure it out. But you know what God says? He says this in Jeremiah 29:11. God says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future, then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I read that scripture because God's got a plan. He created you to serve Him, not to serve the world or maybe stick a funny tail on the back and pretend you're a monkey and climb a tree. He never meant you to be a monkey. He never meant you to be angry and hateful. He didn't create that in you. He created you out of love to love others and to tell others about who He is. So we put on different clothes and we comb our hair differently and we talk differently. But God says, I've got a plan. If you'll just follow me, it'll be a perfect plan. Don't change anything. So as much as we want to change this from a shoebox to a refrigerator, it could never be, okay? You never forget, God's got a purpose for you, okay? Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the day that you've given us in your house already to remind us that these kids are created on purpose. And so, God, I pray that they hear your word today through worship and speaking. I pray they go to school tomorrow to make a difference in their school. I ask in your name, amen. And just in case, does anybody like a little chocolate? Want one?
Thank you.
You're welcome. Make a difference. Yeah. You're welcome.
Now let's all stand as we start our worship service with singing. As we sing, Holy Spirit, rain down. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for coming and visiting with us this morning, Father, to be with us, sustain us, Father, in all that we face. Father, we know that you have said you will never leave our side. Father, so give us the strength and the courage to stay there by you, Father. Other people are trying to leave us. Other things try to take us away from you. Father, we love you. Thank you so much for everything that you do. Father, we thank you for a nation where we can gather and worship you, Father, without fear. Father, I just ask that you be with our leaders in our country today, Father, that you will lift them up, Father, and you will give them the wisdom and the knowledge to know what to do to lead our nation, to bring us back to you. That is our responsibility. We stand for you. That's the only way that we can bring our nation back, is to stand up and claim your name. We thank you so much for your love. We thank you for this church, for this pastor, Father. This morning I pray that you hide behind the cross and that your message will speak to our hearts. You give us strength and courage to answer that call.
Folks, good to have you here this morning. Hopefully you came to worship, and not just to watch, but worshiping is an interactive thing. We've been taking a journey on every Sunday morning, about making a difference. And I don't know how much you think about that in a day-to-day basis. I'm trying to get the slides. There we go. Kind of interesting, huh? Also, truly does is take one light, one candle, one positive statement to really make a difference. And so every Sunday morning or throughout the week, I've been sending out, hey, would you like to get up and give your difference testimony? This is what happened to me. So this morning, we've got a difference maker. We've got Ricky Brooks coming this morning. God's laid on his heart some words that he would like to share with you. So Ricky, you come and speak to us this morning what God's placed on your heart. Don't be scared. You got it, man. It's on.
Steve didn't call me and ask me to give my testimony. I offered to do it after last week's sermon. And then he's been telling me I might talk too long. I thank y'all for letting me come. I did ask Steve if I could give my testimony because the Lord's done a lot for my family and I through the years. My life is a gift. I believe it with all my heart. I forgot, Becca, what script it. It's the scripture that God would above all that we prosper and be in health. I've prayed that my whole life, and I've prayed it over friends and family, and I've prayed it over myself. I want you to think about that scripture and what that means. And then I'd like to say, I don't need you to feel sorry for me after what I'm fixing to tell you. I don't feel sorry for myself. I thank the Lord for the gift that he's been to me and that I have the relationship that I do with him. Yeah. But I started out, I'm going to just give my testimony. I just like everybody else in the Baptist church, I got saved in the Baptist church at Welch, Texas when I was 6. That was also the year I got diabetes. That was in 1965. They didn't know much about diabetes then. I just woke up under an oxygen tent one morning, and they told me my life was going to change. My mother was about 26, I believe. Kids still get to be on their parents' insurance now at 26. They told her I wouldn't live till I was 20, and gave her a book and some. Let her give some shots to a grapefruit and some needles and syringes to boil, and we went home. My mother would baby me, and my dad would not. I'll never forget one day, his words he's always spoke over me is, I don't want to make him a cripple. And I remember one day we were moving pipe, I was tired. And I said, Dad, I think my sugar's low. I need to go to the house. Bam. 3 days later, wake up under the oxygen tent. He said, no, you're not going to use that as an excuse. So we'd rock along. Something would happen. Anyway, I don't know how many times that happened because you couldn't take your blood and get your blood sugar then. It was a lot bigger process. They would have to take it out of my arm, and my arm wasn't that big around then, and they took it a lot. It finally came to the point that they'd have to hold me down. I think then is when I started getting anger, and I didn't know what at. Later on, it ended up being towards the Lord. Because I know the Lord, I know that didn't have to happen, and I couldn't understand why it happened. But you know, the Lord I'm telling you all this, and I'm going into a little detail so I can give the Lord the honor and glory about how he's led me through my life and where I am today and the blessings that he has bestowed upon my family and I. But I went through that. I went through my high school years in pretty much rebellion. I didn't take care of myself. I went to college. I went to college on a rodeo scholarship. I was a typical boy. I mean, we were ornery. And I got married later. I got married when I was 20. She graduated in May. We got married in August. We were kids. And I thought I had the tiger by the tail. We were farming and going. I was rodeoing. We had two beautiful daughters. One morning I woke up and I couldn't see out of my left eye. I could see, but I had to flop blood out of the way. It had bled inside. We went to the doctor. And they did some tests with the Lubbock Health Science Center up in Lubbock. I think I was 28 at the time. They did some tests, looked at my eyes, walked back out and said, "Well, you smoke?" I said, "Yes, I do." "Well, because you smoked and you're a diabetic, the blood vessels in your eyes are growing out into the vitreous of your eyes. You're going to be blind in 6 months. That was just right between the eyes. So we went home trying to figure out how to deal with that. And I got a little angrier. But you know, the Lord, he always... And through this, they started doing laser on my eyes. I ended up with 6,500 laser burns in one eye and 7,500 laser burns in the other eye. They did 500 at a time. Some of them hurt, some of them didn't. Some of them felt like they would thump your eye. My nerves were shot. At that time, farming wasn't too good. We were struggling a little. We were kind of getting hit from all sides. I would go to sleep at night with my wife crying and praying for me. I mean, I want to say here that she's the gift that God gave to me, I believe, to save me. And the quickest way to get her on you is to say anything bad about me today. But we didn't know what to do, so we just kept going. I just kept farming, kept stripping. I was stripping cotton one year, and our pastor came to me, and he said, "Ricky, well, they had told me they'd give me 10% chance to do surgery on that eye, and the right one would go soon. They give me 10% chance of surgery, but they wouldn't do it." And so they just sent us home, didn't tell us we didn't know what to do. I was just working, just trying to figure out what to do. Anyway, our pastor came to me and he said, "Ricky, I found a place that'll give you 25% chance of doing that surgery on your eye." It was Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I think in about 2 weeks we were down there, and they did more laser. And we went back and forth. But anyway, on Christmas, I don't remember what year it was, Becca and I were down there and they were doing surgery on my eye. As they laid me down to do surgery, that pastor was praying that the Lord guide his hands and give him wisdom doing my eye. You don't know what a comfort that is. Because I've never been a fearful person. I've always been a little more the other way. But I was afraid of being blind. My greatest fear was having to be in the house. I never have been in the house person. I go. And I thought, and then I said, Lord, how can you do this? How can I do this to my family? How am I going to make a living? Because at that time we had acquired some debt. And but anyway, they told me when they did that surgery that I would probably get to see light and dark, and that I would be able to get around in the house. But it would be about a year before we knew. And after they did that surgery, it was a pretty rough trip to the house. We couldn't fly. We had to drive, and I couldn't shake my head. I spent 6 weeks laying on my back. Within about 3 months, I not only could see light, I could see things in the house. And my left eye went to getting better and better, better than they thought, better than they thought. In the meantime, they kind of got me under control and got my diabetes kind of under control. And I have friends praying for me all the time. Come to my house, men, come pray for me. I didn't want it. I got it anyway. They were all bigger than me. They pretty much do what they want. But looking back, I see how God just moved me through my life, loving me through it. And all this time I was still angry. But my left eye wasn't good. My right eye could still see. After I got where I could get out, I went ahead and went about my business. Sometimes my right eye would bleed. I couldn't drive for a few days. I could flop the blood to the right, and I could see here, but it would eventually come back to where, and that's what we dealt with for a while. And but things kind of leveled out for a little bit. And then my right eye went. Same thing again. I skipped some. They ended up having to, that was on the left eye, and then in the right eye, what they do when they do that surgery, they go in and take all the inside out of your eye. It's called the vitreous. And they take out the vitreous where the blood vessels can't grow on there like a scaffold, and so it won't bleed. And then they put air back in your eye, and it eventually fills back up with fluid. And my right eye went, and so we did that. And my right eye's my good eyes. That's what I mainly see with. And I know I don't see like y'all. I'm pretty tickled with what I've got. I give the Lord all the honor and glory and praise for that. But don't get mad if I don't shake your hand. If you put it there, I don't see it. Most of my friends poke me in the belly. Now, you're free to also. But we got my eyes lined out. The Lord got my eyes lined out. I did not go blind in 6 months. Things got to going pretty good. But it was always there. At this point, my granddad, he had heart trouble, and he had gone for chelation. And it really helped him. He got his blood circulation back, and he was doing good, and they thought, well, that might help me to have better blood circulation in my eyes. So he paid for me to go to Amarillo to have chelation treatments. Well, you go in there, and they take DNA samples, hair samples, and I don't know what all they did, a bunch of stuff, and did tests and for a day or two. And that doctor walked in there and he said, well, you don't need chelation. You're not going to live another 5 years. And I just went, I can't tell you in church what I told him. My wife was crying. My dad was crying. I was feeling pretty tough right then. But so we come home again, and I got to thinking, what am I going to do? I got to get Beck and the girls set up. I got to get Beck and the girls set up. I don't want to leave them in debt. And I kept trying to think and think, and the Lord kept telling me, give them to me. But I was raised to not be a cripple. I didn't ask for help. And I was taught, you finish what you start. and pretty serious in that deal. And I got anger, and I at God. I was directly at God at that time. And I can remember we went. We had a little old deer lease, and I would go down there. And I didn't do much hunting. I did a lot of thinking. And Becca didn't like me going by myself because I could my blood sugar could get low at night, and something could happen. And I'll tell you, when Becca and I got married, we were kids. We grew up together. And I don't like to be far from her today. I never ask anybody for anything, but if she's the one that can calm me down. She's the one that can cool my jets when I'm fixing to make a fool out of myself. But I wrestled with God. I can honestly say one night down there, I wrestled with God. And I don't know how I converted. Well, all I was told, you could see where I thought I wasn't going to live. And I finally give my family to the Lord. And I hate it. I wasn't going to do that because I treat the Lord just like I do y'all. If I tell you I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it. And I wasn't going to lie to him. And when I give them to him, and that's with somebody else raising my family, my wife marrying somebody else, I think that's probably the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. But I give them to him. And I went home and I figured I was fixed. It's about to be the end of me. It not only was not the end of me, that was the beginning of the rest of our lives. I didn't die. We went to making good crops. I got to doing well. We were doing well. My eyes were stable. I guess at this point I'd like to stop and say, we're not running our lives anyway. I mean, the Lord's doing it. He's just kind enough to let us have enough rope to hang ourselves, I think, till we can come to him and tell him we need him. And when I finally said I couldn't, but he could, he went to blessing me and my family. I not only, at this point I'd like to say, after wrestling with God, I mean, I talked to him, I shook my fist at him, but I began to know him. I began to talk to him. I was so thankful that he let me. He wasn't through with me yet. I mean, I began to get more and more relationship with him. And I began to talk to him like a person. And one day we were driving down the road. I was driving down the road. It's a little over a quarter mile from our house to the highway, and I can usually hit 45 before I have to go slowing down to get to the end of that road. And I said, Lord, I'd like to let my girls rodeo. That's what I did. That's all I know. We weren't too much into the stock show. And I just said it like that. I didn't bow my head or anything. I was just talking. I said, but we don't have the money. Farming the way it is now, you'll just have to bring us the money. Didn't think much more about it. About 2 months later, I had three men come to me from an oil company and told me they had some water they had messed up on our land. And some of my neighbors were suing them. And they sat down at our table and they said, what do you want to do? And I said, well, I think I'd like to work for y'all. And they said, what? I said, yeah. somebody's got to see about all this land y'all are buying. I said, I want to work for you. And they set a salary for me, and I went to work for them. Without me asking, about every 6 months, they'd give me a raise. And the Lord just began to bless us more and more. We got to rodeo, and I got to go, and I was farming 15 circles. I had a ranch leased at Breckenridge. We were blowing and going. Quit talking to the Lord so much. Life was pretty good. There was 1 year we were home 4 weekends out of the year. We were rodeoing so much with my girls. Our girls. I couldn't see. Becca was doing the driving most of that time. But things were good, and we were going, and I was healthy. One night I woke up, and I felt like I'd swallowed some ice. And my chest was hurting. And I sat there for a minute, and I thought, well, I don't remember eating any ice, but I might have. But anyway, I got back up, and I got her to beat on my chest, try to get that on down or whatever it was. She did that a while, and then she said, I think we better go to the doctor. And I said, well, I think we might. So we headed up here to Brownfield. And about halfway, I quit hurting. I said, let's go back, because I didn't want to mess with it. I had stuff going on. And I said, let's go back. No, she wouldn't go back. We come up here, and I was having a full-fledged heart attack. And they were laying me down, ripping my clothes off, sticking needles in, and I said, hey, I got to call my hand. We got pivots going. I got stuff going on. That guy said, you're having a heart attack. I said, well, I'm going to talk to that hand, or you're not going to touch me again. So he let me call my hand, and as he's putting me down, he said, you're a type A aggressive personality, and I'm going to slow you down. Now he tells me I wanted you to slow down, not stop, because I've gained 40 pounds. Since I had that heart attack. But anyway, that was in 2003. And then in 2005, I had another one. They put two stents in 2003. And then they put two more in 2005. I remember each heart attack by something that happened. And Steve, I'm sorry I'm going so long, but I got to tell all this. I'm not aimlessly wondering. I have a point to make at the end of this. But on the second heart attack, he told Becca, the doctor said, now, I got to tell you, he looked at her and he said, you know what's going on, don't you? And he said, you know, you made it here this time. And he started doing like this. And have any of you ever heard a dog start going like right before they're fixing to bite? That was her sucking air because she's fixing to let him have it, and I knew he was fixing to get it. He said what he said, and she said, listen, we serve a mighty God. And she said, she began to explain to him the world the way we believe it. He's still my doctor, but he doesn't talk like that to us anymore. Anyway, I'm doing good again. Everything's good again. 2010, chest goes to hurt, and we make another trip. This time we went to Lubbock, because they always took us to Lubbock. I just told Becca, I took a nitro. She's saying stop. I said, I think we can make it. And I was thinking, Lord, if it's my time this time, let her rip. I said, I'm tired of worrying about it. And so we made it to Lubbock. Right before we pulled into the heart hospital, they had three ambulances coming in with people having heart attacks. And they sat me down. And I didn't know it, but at the time I had like a 95% blockage in a vein. But when we sat down, there were two black ladies in there, and they were smiling, looking at us. And just real friendly. And I'm telling you, I was like a grizzly bear. I was hurting. And I was thinking, they're going to want to talk. I don't want to talk. So I would just look down, and I would just look down. And we sat there a little bit, and we were waiting on them to do our paperwork. And this black man come in. He's a bebopping along there, and he begged three steps in that door, and Becca said, "That's an angel." And I said, "What?" She said, "That's an angel." I didn't think anything about it. So he went on back, and their mother had a heart attack, and they were up there seeing about her. He came back out, and he kept looking at me, and I was looking down. I thought, I don't want to talk. And here in a minute, he came over to me, and he said, "What's your name?" I said, "Ricky." He said, "Ricky who?" I said, "Ricky Brooks." He said, "Ricky Brooks, that's a famous name." I said, "No, it's not." He said, "Yeah, it is." And I was looking down, and I'll never forget it. He squatted down, and he put his hands together, raised my head up, looking at him, and I'm telling you, I was in the presence of God. And he said, "That's a famous name. You keep your eyes on the Lord." And he didn't act. He wouldn't bebop. He just walked out. It wasn't too funny after that. But I guess y'all know that God is no respecter of persons. So if I have a famous name, everybody sitting here that's professed Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior has a famous name in heaven. I want you to know that. That's just the Lord letting me know. That's just the Lord communicating with me. And I feel like I need to share that with y'all. Because I know God is no respecter of persons. He loves us all the same. But anyway, we got through that. Made it through that all right. I'm not sure. I know there's no coincidence with the Lord, but I mean, we went in there and they put another stent in. I'm talking about them like they're easy. It's not, but we were home the next afternoon. And I think sometimes, anyway, the Lord gets us in a place where we can hear Him. But I said all that to say this. My whole life I had prayed that I would above all, He would above all that we prosper and be in health. I never prayed the end of that verse, "even as your soul prospers." This is 2017. I'm 57. I've got 20/40 in my left eye and 20/25 in my right. And I can probably when we work cows, I can outwork all those boys. They'll have their tongue hanging out, and I'm still going. And I know that's just the Lord. I know that I know that I've been through some stuff to be able to handle what we've had to go through in our life, but He also gave me the tools. And I want to say, you know, the people that He sent in my life, when He sent them, I could tell you more. I'm just worried I'm going over time. I've got a lot more. But like I went on a walk. On that walk, all those guys were dancing and singing, acting like idiots. I thought I was mad. I just went keep a guy from nagging at me anymore. There was a guy talking on that walk. He looked like a Hell's Angel. Big white beard, had the hat, done the whole deal. I sat up there thinking, what is this? When he cut through with his walk, he came walking back down the aisle, and I looked at him. I stood up and looked at him. I said, "I judged you." He said, "I know." And I told him I was sorry. Also on that walk, I was still pouting, throwing my fit because I was on it. And, you know, I had to sit around this table with these guys. And man, I did. This guy had to sit by. He had long hair. He was not very clean. And he had a hacking cough. And that's all I could think about is, yeah, Lord, you brought me up here to get me a cold. I'm sitting here. And with him, and we went through that on Saturday. We were having a discussion, and everybody was talking and everything. And that when it came to this man's, young guy's time to talk, he said, I don't think I should be here. And somebody said, why? He said, because I'm not as good as y'all. And that broke my heart. And he said, kind of find out he didn't have a dad. He went washing dishes and stuff when he was 9. He'd wash dishes, and that's how he kind of took care of himself. And anyway, somebody had asked him, said, could you think you might change clothes? I mean, he's... hope I don't get in trouble for saying this, but he smelled like a goat. And anyway, come to find out, I was the only one at the table that was the same size as he was. And I took him back into the room. I had 3 shirts and 3 pairs of pants in there, 2 new pair and a little older pair that were light blue. I really liked those light blue pants. And I got him some of those new pants, and he looked right past me and said, man, I like those light blue pants. So that guy wore my pants home. And I believe that was when the Lord began to give me a heart for his people and teach me to love his people again and began to break down the walls that I had put up through what I had been through. And I feel like I've skipped around in here from what I was going to say, but I'm sure the Lord got said what he wanted to say. I felt like he told me, throw it out there and I'll sort out the pieces. But two years ago at Christmas, my prayer was always, back when the girls were little and stuff, Lord, I got to see these girls raised and married. Or I got to see them taken care of. And 2 years ago, at Christmas, my mother and dad were there, and both girls are married. We had one grandchild. And we prayed and told the Lord what we were thankful for. And you should have heard my son-in-law's pray for my daughters. And you should have heard those girls pray for their husbands and to the Lord. And I wish you could have heard my wife pray. And all I could pray was, Lord, thank you for this extraordinary life. And back to that scripture I told you about, what above all that we prosper and be in health, even as our soul prospers. That, contrary to what I thought, that doesn't mean that we're never going to be sick and we're going to be rich. That means that we get to have relationship with Christ. That's his gift to us. It's our relationship with him. If we have that relationship, all these other things, like working in children's church and ministry and praying for the sick and feeding the needy, they will be added unto us. We won't want to do it. It won't be a burden. My prayer for you is, I just hope that, and I'm sure you do, but I hope that you can know the Lord Jesus Christ like I do. And that I want you to look back on your life, and I'm sure everybody, when you go looking back, you'll see how God structured your life. He says our paths are, he has a plan for us, and he goes before us to prepare the way. Make no mistake, he knows what he's doing. Thank you.
Amen. Absolutely. And that's, as Ricky's talking, I'm looking behind him on the big screen there. One light bulb and the rest dark. And Ricky talks about all he can see is light and dark. That's all the doctor said. But that doctor is flesh and blood, and Ricky didn't serve flesh and blood. He serves a being called God. And we call him Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. And that's exactly what he did. And all this journey Ricky's talking about is, God can't make a difference. God can't use me to make a difference. Surely he can't use me, can he? Yes, he can. He absolutely can, if you're willing to step out of that dark place and come to the light and believe in who God is. And truly stand on that solid rock of Jesus Christ and not remember who you were or what the doctor said you can't do or what might even happen. But believe in a God who says, I have come that you might have life and live it to the fullest or abundantly or overflowing. And that's what Ricky did. He could have pulled the blanket of it's over him and said, I'm done. But he serves a God. He says, I'm not done with you. God can't use me to make a difference, can he? Sure he can. If you're willing to step out and be a difference maker. It's like we've been talking about the t-shirts right here. They're out there on a table, and well, I don't have money. I don't care if you don't have money. T-shirts aren't going to make a difference sitting on a table. They're going to make a difference you wearing them or giving them to somebody who you believe is a difference maker. I can't read Hebrew, and that's why I chose Hebrew. And somebody says, hey, what's that on the front of your shirt? It's the word difference, and it's different. But isn't that what Christ called us to do, is to make a difference? That's what Ricky did. He didn't give up. He didn't quit. He's continuing to make a difference. My challenge to you this morning is, are you giving up? Are you done? Are you living back yesterday? I said it before and I'll say it again. We can't serve God yesterday. We can't serve Him tomorrow because it's not here. We can only serve Him today. You can only make a difference today. The challenge is, will you? Will you step up and believe He can make a difference not only to you, but through you? If you'll let Him. Would you stand with me, please? God, you are the difference maker. You spoke the word and the universes and the galaxies were created. You knew me before I was even formed in my mom's womb. You know who I would be, who I am, who I'm going to be. Your word says, teach me to number my days. That means I'm dying. God, don't let me waste my time. So God, I thank you for Ricky Brooks. The life that he has lived up to this very day is a testimony of who you are. You are a difference-making God if we'll allow you to do that. You can work through anyone if that person would allow you to work not just in them, but through them. So God, this morning, as we sing an invitation, we're not singing to invite people to me. We're singing to invite people to you. A life-changing, difference-making God. And we can say in here that we're going to make a difference, but it doesn't mean anything unless we go out there and make a difference. So God, as we gather here, as we rise up and bend or bow our heads and close our eyes, may we just see you. And may we say, God, I want to make a difference. I ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Ricky, that was a very good testimony. Thank you. If I can get through this song, I hope that you will realize that God is great. I'm not on an ego trip. I'm nothing on my own. Make mistakes often slip. This common flesh and bone. But someday I'll prove just twice say I'm of a special kind. For when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. For he knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heaven shine. So unworthy of such mercy, yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. The look of love was on his face. Thorns were on his head. Blood was on the scarlet robe, stained a crimson red. Though his eyes were on the crowd that day, he looked ahead in time. For when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. For he knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heavens shine. So unworthy of such mercy, yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind.
Let us pray. Our dear Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. Just thank you for the many wonderful blessings you give us, Lord. Lord, I thank you for the testimony that we heard this morning. I just thank you for being with Ricky during this time, Lord, just to giving him the strength to come through what he has come through in his life, Lord. Just thank you for his family. Lord, just want to thank you for this church. Thank you for my church family. And Lord, I just thank you for each and everyone here today, Lord. And Lord, just be it the ones that have been in the hospitals, Lord, and ones that have lost loved ones in the past week. Lord, just bless this time of our service. Just bless the gift and the giver. May it be used unto thy will. We ask these things in Jesus' name, pray. Amen.
What an amazing morning. I pray you were inspired. I pray you were challenged not to give up on life. No matter what Satan throws at you every single day or maybe every single moment, you can be an overcomer. You can be a difference maker because we serve a God who does just that. He makes difference in our lives every single moment of every day. Would you stand with me, Cherie? Can we play on out of here this morning? Ray, come on up.
Thank you. I'm sorry.
Jerry did me the same way he did you.
Oh.
He walked over to me and said, I'm playing.